In the haze of history, we know that for at least 1,000 years, boats have landed on the beaches of North Norfolk. And until the present century, a common form of construction was used for the various sizes of clinker-built, double-ended wooden vessels. The end of the 20th century saw the coming of other materials. Into the current century, a new style of boat. Nets and hooks, oars and sails, pots and power. There's been consistency and change throughout the centuries. With no harbours for many miles, the open beach has to be the base for the fishermen of Cromer and Sheringham, Runton and Overstrand, Munsley and Weybourne. As well as fishing, modern research suggests we may have long underestimated the use our ancestors made of the sea for transport. Today we think of maps on a north-south axis. If we ignore this orientation, we can perceive countries sharing the border of the North Sea. Romans, Angles, Saxons and Vikings traversed the waters in the course of trade. Archaeology indicates the borders of the ocean that provided sustenance in the first millennium. Sites such as Sedgeford in West Norfolk show plentiful oyster and mussel shells. Archaeology in Norwich has the bones of cod and many examples of herring from early Norman times. St. Bennet's Abbey and Binham Priory remind us of the church's requirement for fish to eat on Fridays and many other special days. They had ponds and lakes in medieval times, but it's in these years we can witness the exploitation of the sea for food gaining momentum. The written record also begins to supply some information. Between the trading ports of Great Yarmouth and King's Lynn were many little ports, homes for fishing vessels small and large. In King Edward III's fleet, not a standing navy, but a collection of vessels drawn together for war, there were 61 ships of Yarmouth, Lynn and Blakeney. Diplomatic records show vessels from Clyde, Wiverton and Cromer were trading far afield and sometimes being attacked. In 1345, the record shows that the hamlet of South Creek purchased nearly 7,000 herring from Cromer. The merchants of the town, together with Clyde, Blakeney and Wiverton, were given special trading licences for fish. And by 1391, taxes were being levied on fish landed at Cromer for the upkeep of the pier. "For every last of herring exposed for sale, 2 pence. For every 100 of fish called orgoys reckoned by 10 score, 12 pence. For every lob, ling and cod, 6 pence. For every boat called fisher laden with merchandise, 1 pence. Early in the 15th century, Henry V built up the nation's sea power and campaigned in France, including at Agincourt. With his fleet at Caen were Roger Rask, a mariner, and John Clement, mariner, serving on the Trinity of Cromer, Simon Falconer, serving on the James of Cromer, Wills Richmond, serving on the Nicholas of Cromer. And 7 more vessels were mentioned, vessels of sufficient size to have made the journey down the coast and across the channel. Was James, a Scottish prince, captured by Cromer mariner Roger Bacon off Flamborough Head? Did Bacon discover Iceland for fishing? A contemporary chronicler, William of Worcester, secretary to John Falstaff at Caister Castle, says so. John Spark of Cromer had a cottage called Blober House. Does this indicate a link with whaling? As well as men and boats being mentioned in the 15th and 16th century records, we have more detail of piers at Cromer and at Sheringham. These were not likely to have been what we think of as piers today, but perhaps substantial efforts to create breakwaters, sometimes at an angle, to provide at least some shelter for the local boats. We can only catch glimpses of the fishermen and seafarers of Cromer and Sheringham from those early centuries, some doubtless operating locally, some venturing much further afield. But by 1724, those specializations that we know today had begun to appear. It's Daniel Defoe on his journey through the eastern counties who gives us the clue. Cromer is a market town close to the shores of this dangerous coast. I know nothing it is famous for, besides being the terror of the sailors, except good lobsters which are taken off the coast in great numbers, carried to Norwich in such quantity too, as to be conveyed to London. We also pick up references from this time to lobster coys, a type of cage for keeping lobsters in once they'd been caught, probably pegged down on the beach close to the low water mark. The keeping of fresh lobsters ready for market remains an issue today. With the buzz of pumps and refrigeration in the background, Cromer fisherman John Davis.
See, this is one of our lobster storage tanks. A chilled seawater circulating through a pump, one of these filters, and that just keeps the water circulating oxygenated. And you know, we can keep these lobsters in here for, you know, a month at a time if you want to. Peak season, you know, the catch are changing daily, but the main advantage of this to what they had years ago, you can store lobsters and hold them. A stainless steel pipe run through, fit a compressor outside, and a chill down, and just keep it at a constant temperature. Marketing point of view makes it very, very easy. Simply because if I want to send, you know, some customers buy a ton of lobsters at a time, at the minute there's not many in here, but, you know, sometimes there's a lot more lobsters than there is water, believe it or not. And, yeah, you can, you know, a Vivia lorry come to you, or a big dealer, and he'll pick a ton up at a time, and why they'll go off fresh to market. Because when you come home, especially summertime, it's a hot day, you know, your lobsters are flagging in that heat. So you get them in here, put them in a tank, that refresh them, and even if you've got to deliver them dry and chilled, you know, they'll keep that much better, and, you know, you'll look after your stock, as simple as that. Years ago, they would be, when I first started, we sent any away, they'd be packed in sawdust.
Going back to the 18th century, we began to find the evidence for a specialist crab and lobster fishery in North Norfolk, alongside the general fishery. Cod, herring, whelks, mackerel, and other whitefish were caught when season and weather permitted. This would remain the case until relatively recent times. Willie Cox started full-time fishing in 1957, though whilst at school he had helped his father. Mackerel remained an important catch.
Mackerel fishing in the summer times. Drift netting. When I come home from school, I'd go to bed for 2 or 3 hours and then get up and we'd go away as the sun was... Well, you'd get away so you shot your nets as the sun was setting. And you were a little wide, you see, not like long, when you were longshore and you were along the edge. And you'd sometimes, you'd hear the mackerel hit the net, because they swam so fast, you'd actually hear the mackerel hit the net, and you'd, after a little while, you'd haul and clean, pick, because you had to pick all your mackerel out. You couldn't shake them out like a heron. You had to pick them out, and you'd perhaps haul one or two nets till you come to that bunch of mackerel, and then shoot the nets away again. A mackerel net, I don't know what it was done in, whether it was done in an oil or what, but it was much firmer, harder meshed net, and it was a good job it was, because if not, you'd have broke every mesh when you took the mackerel out. Whether that was herring catching or mackerel catching, you had to have fine weather, and you had a boot full of nets before you went. The only other difference I can remember about with a herring net, the corks were always round, except perhaps the end cork on the net. But on a mackerel net, the corks are always flat.
While some will occasionally make the foray for herring or mackerel, it is no longer commonplace. Though occasionally the early hours see nets being scudded clean of herring. Part of the problem is that the public has lost its taste for the fish. Even if a full boatload comes ashore, getting a reasonable price can be difficult. Nevertheless, a late evening foray for herring is still sometimes taken on, though a shoal of silver in the sea these days sometimes proves to be sea bass rather than the silver darlings of old. A bit of modern assistance to get the oak shavings burning and the smoke gently wafts up for a few hours. It's a method of preserving the catch that is centuries old. 250 years ago, any catch was welcomed. In 1771, there was a local society of 123 fishermen, which entered into an agreement for regular supply of the London market. And in 1798, Edmund Bartell, writing about Cromer as a picturesque watering place, also said, "Lobsters, crabs, whiting, codfish and herring are all caught here in the finest perfection. The lower class of people are chiefly supported by fishing. The herring which are caught here are cured in the town, a house having been erected for that purpose, which, I believe, answers well both to the proprietor and the fishermen, who now find an immediate market for any quantity they may bring in." It's from this era that we begin to pick up more detailed information on the fishermen and their families. The census records of Sheringham and Cromer, Runton and Overstrand give fishermen as a profession. Names appear in the records that would be carried through to the well-known fishing families of the 20th century. The Harrisons, Rooks, Allens and Knockles are all earning their living at sea. Lining was a form of fishing that was commonplace in that era and survived through to the end of the 20th century. Now, it too has become a rarity. Willie Cox.
There was a bit of lining for cod done before he left school, and I can also remember him laying lines in the summertime for skate. One of the first times I ever went laying lines was for soles. And that was when I'd left school, and me and my father went off one morning to haul the crab pots. And before we hauled the crab pots, we laid a pack of lines, and they were always a longer pack for that fishing. They were smaller hooks. They used to be called pin hooks because they were that small, on account of a sole only having a small mouth.
Long lining for skate, cod and soles required considerable preparation. Hundreds of hooks needed baiting. Once the lines were simply coiled, but then bathtubs became a popular way of stowing them.
The next time I can remember going lining was, I aren't sure if that was the first winter I left school, or the second. We went and laid some lines for some cod. And that morn, we went away right early in the morn and came all the way down to Overstrand and laid some lines. I can't remember how far off. I don't think it was very far off. And we went ashore at Overstrand, just pulled the boat round, left her where she was, and we walked up the beach. And as a boy, in the first time I'd been to Overstrand, that seemed ever such a long beach to walk up, and a very high cliff.
They took advantage of the warmth of the stove in the Overstrand fisherman's hut and left a note of thanks. Hopefully, the lines had attracted a catch.
And then I think it would be perhaps a couple of hours later, we went back down onto the beach, went off, hauled the lines, and then went back to Munsley. But that's a long while ago now.
Now, it has to be said that so far in this story, we've spoken a great deal about Cromer and little of Sheringham. That's simply because much of the evidence from earlier years is for Shipton and then Cromer, Sheringham being an inland village that we now call Upper Sheringham. But the fishing station on the coast was gradually expanding, even before the considerable boom that came with the arrival of the railway. That tourism boom of the late 19th and early 20th centuries has given us a rich collection of photographs. The pinnacle of the photographic record was the work of Olive Edis, who maintained studios in London and in Sheringham. She found the rugged faces of the fishing community ideal for her style of photography. The cottages of the old town, the fishing stations on the east and west beaches, and the work on the beach were recorded by many others. The older style gear from before the days of plastic, the making and mending of whelk and crab pots, the gatherings on the beach and promenade, are all seen in the photographs. With so many fishermen with the same name, there was a particularly rich selection of nicknames in order to distinguish one from another. And behind the fishermen stood the Upshur family, who exercised their patronage through funding some of the fishing boats and through the provision of two lifeboats. It's through these photographs, as well as the licensing records, that we can see just how many boats there were in town towards the end of the 1800s. It's reckoned that up to 125 vessels worked off the beach, and it must have been a precarious existence in more ways than one. It's no wonder that we hear of the migration of whole families from Sheringham, often heading north for the towns of Grimsby and Scarborough. And a part of the community was, and is, deeply embedded with the Salvation Army. Missioners Willie Long and John West were ardent preachers from the Methodist community. But the day-to-day work around 1900 was the preparation and maintenance of the boats, most of which were built in the town, and the setting off to sea with a simple sail or set of sails and a pair of oars. Both Sheringham and Cromer are fortunate to have their fishing heritage recorded in their museums, and our final photo in this section is of the Garden of the Mow, the site that has now become the town's museum. The sea, whilst providing the harvest for the fishermen, could also be his greatest danger. In 1822, 11 Cromer fishermen perished in one storm. The Great Gale of 1836 led to the building of the first seawall at Cromer. The wind was so severe that landowners with properties on the cliff top also suffered greatly. Simeon Simon's bathhouse was washed away. One man was drowned as he tried to rescue some of the furnishings there. A moderate gale, when pots were at sea, always results in a loss of kit, even if the boats themselves had stayed ashore. The severe gales of 1953 and 2007 fortunately came in the winter months, and these days come with due warning, enabling boats to be brought back into positions of safety. Nevertheless, fishermen still suffer the loss of a great deal of gear when there's a storm and their pots are in position. And it's not hard to envisage the considerable damage that was done to anything on the seafront when one of the major storms occurred. The waves make a dramatic effect as they bounce back off the concrete defences. But in 1836 there was no such seawall, and every wave would have taken a little more from the undefended cliff, as it does on other parts of the Norfolk coast today. Fishing families living not far from the cliff edge must have been in great fear for their lives and property at such times. Clearly, some boats were at sea in a gale in 1801. A subscription list records the appeal made to help those who suffered. It having been suggested by many charitable and humane persons in the vicinity of Runton and Cromer that it would be proper to raise a sum of money for the widows of the unfortunate sufferers, four in number, who perished in the late tremendous gale of the 2nd of November, 1801, as also to assist those industrious fishermen of Cromer who lost their boat and nets in the same storm, it is hoped that the following statement will excite the charity of the generous and benevolent in the neighbourhood. Drowned, Shearman Cutler. He has left a widow and 4 small children. William Luff, a widow and 3 small children. James Crask, a widow and 1 child. John Crask, a widow. Runton, nets, etc. Lost and damaged, £20. Cromer, boat, nets, etc. £61.06. The tradition amongst fishing communities has always been to raise money by public subscription to meet such disasters, and in this instance, £95.13 was raised. £64 going to the dependents of the dead, the remainder being distributed amongst those fishermen who had lost gear in proportion to their loss. One memorial of death at sea recalls that it was not just in the local fishing that danger lurked. Until the middle of the 19th century, a number of more substantial vessels were owned and crewed from the towns. Most fishing boats were largely 2- or 3-man vessels operated locally, but other vessels took the Cromer and Sheringham men much further afield. Known locally as the Great Boats, these vessels were luggers, a name applied from the style of their sails. A fleet of luggers appears faintly in this photograph, behind the coal ship Wensleydale, lying off Cromer Gangway. Employing a dozen men, they would voyage down to Scarborough, Grimsby and the Dogger Bank. They might carry smaller vessels on board, which could be used to assist in the catching of crabs. It's said that they brought live crabs from the Yorkshire coast to replenish the local stock, and this led to a tradition of referring to crabs of a lighter brown colour as Yorkshiremen. At that time, the local catching of crabs was a slow and tedious process, undertaken by using hoop nets, not unlike the nets used today for catching crabs from Cromer Pier. Cromer fisherman Richard Davis talked about the use of these nets in a reenactment at Cromer Museum.
Hello, I was then having a half hour in a chair. Well, that's nice to see you, girl. Yeah, I'll get the missus to put the kettle on, we'll have a cup of tea. I'll now strip this hoop, put the net on the fire. That's what we catch the crabs with. We work about, I have about 50 I take. Some of the boats have got 60. If they got a couple of young boys with them, they might have a few more. We put these in every day with a bit of bait.
Robert Martin's diary of 1825 indicates that some sort of pot was used at Cromer in an earlier period, but the Yorkshire pots were clearly a significant development. It was not long after the coming of these pots that Government Fisheries Inspector Frank Buckland arrived in North Norfolk to undertake a study of the fisheries. His report of 1875 gives us a broadly reliable picture of the fishery at that time, though holding the investigation at Cromer does seem to have given the opportunity for the Cromer men to have put all the blame for any overfishing squarely on the shoulders of the Sheringham fishermen. Perhaps if the inquiry had been held in Sheringham, it might have been the other way round. I have ascertained that the crab and lobster fisheries, which are all public fisheries, and at present are carried on without any legislation whatever in this neighbourhood, may be defined by the following limits. The Cromer fisheries begin on the eastward at a point opposite Sidestrand and extend as far as West Runton. Cromer itself is situated about the middle of this district. The Sheringham fisheries begin on the eastward at Runton and extend westward to about opposite Weybourne. It appears that the crab and the lobster fisheries, the principal industry of this neighbourhood, and of immense importance to the inhabitants, have fallen off and become impoverished in the last few years to an alarming degree. Mr. Edmund Bayfield of Sheringham, over 60 years in the fishing trade, writes me that he could formerly take more good-sized crabs in one day than can now be got in a week, and only the small crabs which are sent to market at London, Norwich and elsewhere. This is mostly owing to the crab pots that came into use 12 or 14 years ago, and there are about 100 crab boats at Sheringham, and each boat have 20 pots, so they bait 2,000 pots. The crabs at Cromer and the neighbourhood are counted by a peculiar standard. Thus, two crabs are counted as one, the two crabs being called a cast. 60 cast of crabs is called 100. At Cromer, therefore, 100 crabs is 240. If one boat catches in two tides fishing 10 casts or 20 crabs, it is considered a bad catch. A good catch would be 3/4 of a Cromer 100 or 180 crabs. Well, that's all clear then. Well, clear enough for anyone who might be paying too much attention to something that's not their business. The outcome of this inquiry is that the recommendations of Cromer businessman Henry Sandford for a size limit on catching crabs was introduced, and small crabs could no longer be broken up at sea and used as bait. The coming of the crab pots, coupled with the greatly improved ability to reach markets brought by the arrival of the railway, was thus balanced by these regulations. Just as today, the activities of the fishermen on the beach attracted the attention of photographers. Daniel Davison, Cromer chemist, took a splendid set of plates, and we think some others may have been taken by the Reverend Arthur Buxton. From these pictures, we can occasionally gain a glimpse of activities which have long passed. Here, bags are loaded with flints from the beach. These were used for ballast, and if the boat tacked through the wind, they were all shifted from one side of the boat to the other. The boats were moved up and down the beach by muscle power. The procedure was to put the oars through the oruch holes on either side of the boat and use them for handles. Willie Cox was still using this method when he started fishing at Munsley using a rowing boat.
I would have been again a stern shoving, but my brother Bob and George, they would just ship an oar in the forward oruch hole, and they would just pick her up and you'd just push her across the beach. And that's how they got them up and down. And that's years and years ago, when they went, they would get the boat down to the water's edge and then carry whatever had to go in the boat, pots or whatever, carry them down to the boat at the water's edge, likewise when they come ashore.
Another daily task for the fishermen is and was the cutting of bait and the preparing of the pots. At sea, the bait is sorted in the boxes. Our 1900s photos show the cutting of the bait on the beach. Buttons Harrison and his son make use of an improvised table. The drying of herring nets might take place on the sands, and a good catch would provoke interest from all. Whilst the fishermen were generally private in their work, they needed to work together in the launching and recovering of the boats. And just one photo exists at Cromer to illustrate a group of the local boats under sail together. The fishermen seem to have been more than willing to pause for a group photo on the beach and to show off a good catch of cod. It's 5 a.m. A splendid film made in Sheringham in the 1950s by Brian Coe captured the operation of the crab and lobster fishery in the middle of the 20th century. The boats in the film are launched from the East Beach. Using one camera, he's clearly filmed over several days to capture the various aspects of the fishermen's work. All work together to get to the water's edge, and we're soon at sea. Brian Coe films both other boats and the boat he's in. We're in the days of hand-hauling the pots. He shows the quick emptying and rebaiting of the pots, then their storage on board, ready to be shot again. Once a refreshed shank of pots is ready, over goes the Dan boy with the marker flag, then an anchor for the boy. Each pot follows in turn, and then finally another anchor and marker boy. A measure is used to check the size of each crab, and those undersize are thrown back into the water. On their return to the beach, the boat is left in the breakers, whilst kit, perhaps pots needing repair, is carried up the beach. The winch wire is run out down the stones and the boat pulled onto a skeet, a simple pair of rollers. As each skeet emerges from behind the boat, it's brought round and used again. So the boat makes its way across the level sand of the beach and then up the steep bank of stones. While Sheringham had a winch on the east beach and a winch on the west beach, it was still an exhausting process, moving the skeets and keeping the boat upright, whilst the stones slipped away under your feet. A final tilt of the boat, and she's on the level at the top of the beach. Stools would form props to hold her upright. The process of packing the crabs ready for transport then begins. At that time, many would be sent live to the fish merchants of Norwich, King's Lynn and London. Packed into wooden boxes, sheets of sacking were tacked around each box and a label attached. Each case is clearly branded so that the right boxes are identified once at the market. Onto the scales at the station, then onto the railway barrow for loading. The filmmaker takes a shot of the label of a fish merchant in Billingsgate. Other crabs will be sold locally, and the West family specialises in producing a popular crab paste. The repairing of pots and nets would be the next job, though we do take time to see a new crab boat emerge from Emery's boat building shop. A lad in the boat has a model of it, and of course a bottle has to be broken on the bow. Most of the fishing community seems to be there for the occasion, and lend a hand to slide her down to the water. Again, skeets are laid along the road and across the beach to help to keep her moving. Backs are bent to oars as she makes her way through a gentle swell. Once Miss Britain has embarked on her maiden voyage, we're back to the more mundane process of preparing the bait for the morrow. Fish not wanted for the market, the bycatch of trawling, has arrived by lorry from Lowestoft. It needs cutting up into sizes suitable to bait the pots when they're hauled again the next morning. Or maybe there's a catch of herring that needs gutting, ready to be salted down and sold. Before heading off, probably for a couple of hours' afternoon sleep, there's a marvel to talk through the day's events. The full version of Brian Coe's unique film is today cared for by the East Anglian Film Archive. John Worthington spent much of his life fishing from Runton, and then from the Overstrand beach. In his 80th year, he could still pull an oar, especially when there was a visit from a restored lifeboat to celebrate 200 years of the Cromer lifeboat station. He has a comprehensive knowledge of the way that motive power developed for the crab boat.
Marine engines, there was what they call a Belfast Barker. That was a single cylinder, but that was a make and break. That didn't have a spark and plug, that had another arrangement. The spark came off a contact off a battery, you know, like the car battery or the battery we have today, one stand here. And that used to form the electrical part of the system. And there's a bang, 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 had a silencer on it, weren't a water cooled exhaust then, because you had to mind you didn't go and put your hand on it, because it would be red hot, you know. But you used to position it underneath a thought, after thought, and out of the side, as against now, as out of the stern.
There was a gradual development in the efficiency of the engines.
But I think the most successful engine was the Brook Marine from Lowestoft or Alton Broad. And there was, they made various engines, but the two what were used around here was the Brook Dominion, which was a two-cylinder engine, or the four-cylinder they made, which was the Brook Empire. But you see, you had to keep the weight down, so you couldn't have too large an engine or anything heavy. You didn't have no diesels then, because all diesel engines were very heavy, weren't they? No good for beach work, because then they reduced the weight of them considerably. And we come in onto the Perkins and BMC and all them sort of things. But they were the main engine, or the Rolls Royce, I would say, of crab boat engines, was the Brook Marine.
Even though there was an engine, oars and a sail still seemed like a good idea.
Well, them days, they still carried, mainly, if you got to do any distance, carried a mast and sail. as a secondary, or even on a good day, you could sail fast and you could motor, couldn't you? But then, of course, they were discarded when the Brooke engine came in. And then other makes followed. When I was at Runton, we had, I forget what the devil the name of that, not Kermuth, something similar, name, American engine, damn good engine they were, a twin cylinder, pretty powerful too. We didn't know an awful lot, and an engine was simple really, but it didn't seem simple in them days, did it?
A mechanic often had to be called in to help, but there were various tricks you could try yourself.
Used to, in the morning when it's cold, to try and get them to start, used to put the plug in a hand cup of petrol and set fire to it, get it hot, or pencil it with a lead pencil on the end to improve the spark, didn't you, to get them to go. Oh dear, that was, you never knew where it's going to go. But then, I say, when I returned to fishing, I had this new boat built, the Early Rose. She's over at Thingbob now. David Davis bought her off me after I finished. And she's over at Stiffkey. And Boy Hewitt's boat builders, I was only having a look at her a week ago. But I had a new Perkins 4107 diesel engine in. And that was the first successful diesel engines. Richard David ordered one because he had the next boat built to me. I ordered one as well, so he had one put in his, JJ&F. And I had this one put in the Early Rose. And they were the first real diesels. They were, these Perkins, were the same engine what you used to have in the beach lifeboat.
This boat at Overstrand once fished regularly from the beach there, for its latter years with a pot hauler.
Can't see it here because it's on the other side. The capstan on the side, which is worked off a hydraulic pump on them. And of course they got different sorts now. They got another sort of engine, what they use on these boats, which have two cheeks, you know, and they have their haul up forward instead of up. And they have a separate little engine for that, like a small Honda or some similar type, you know, of engines.
The pot hauler had certainly made a great difference.
A lot of difference to your hands and arms in general, you know, of course, and of course they can work more gear, for having pot haulers, which they do. But, you know, when you had to haul them all by hand, well, you know you'd done it, didn't you?
We've already heard how the latter stages of the 20th century saw a significant change in the design of the boats. Willie Cox.
Mostly on the beaches we've gone back. It's the proper crab boat, as you know, you could pick them up and carry them. Motor boats came before I went to sea, but I can remember them changing a lot from the boats what were built at Sheringham were nowhere near as heavy as the motor boats what were built a few years later at Lynn. The motor boats at Lynn were heavier than the Sheringham built boats, and they, over the years, they gradually got bigger and bigger. Someone would have one built a foot longer than another, or a plank higher, and they just got bigger and bigger. The engines got bigger and heavier. Then we had the hydraulic haulers put in them.
The Mary Ann is the last of the wooden double-ended style of boat working off the beaches of Cromer and Sheringham.
Firstly, that happened at Sheringham when they went single-handed. And then after a few years, we done the same here, a couple on us. And so, in fact, I think boats are gone. They went from small to large and then went back again. The reason we went single-handed was we had a church tree bad years, and to carry on, we had to cut down in some way, and we'd seen how they managed to churn them, so we thought we'd do the same. I talked to little Billy, and he said to me, he said he'd been in the center boat, he'd ordered one. So he said to him, I'll come through and have a look at it. And when I went and had a look at it, I said, that's fair enough, I'll do the same. And that's when Billy and I first went single-handed. We were the first two to do it at Cromer. But we had two or three bad years. But that you get bad years, but you get good years. I think at Sheringham it was very much that they wouldn't. They didn't have no better years, but that there was no younger people there, or very few. There was a few younger people at Cromer. Having said that, not a great deal, but there was even less at Sheringham. And I think that was the way they went there, was partially that reason they couldn't recruit crews for all the boats. So that's why they went single-handed.
We don't intend going into the matter of nicknames in this video. Suffice to say, there was a need to distinguish between Little Billy Davis and Blonde Billy Davis.
The years I went on my own single-handed, I thoroughly enjoyed, I must admit. Thoroughly enjoyed it. I got to know one or two seagulls quite well, and we used to talk to each other. But no, I loved this going on my own, I'll be honest. I thoroughly enjoyed it. That was a bit of trial and error to start with. But yes, I enjoyed it.
The present-day skiffs make use of an outboard motor rather than the inboard motor of the older boats.
When you realised the power you had, you felt safer, because especially coming ashore, you had to be a bit careful hauling and especially shooting parts away. Because you were there on your own, you had to keep your feet flat on the deck. You didn't want to. You had to learn to shuffle your feet and not pick them up. But coming ashore, you sometimes had to ease the boat down. Because you were going that quick, you were afraid of overtaking the sea in front on you. You didn't have to worry about any of them astern on you, because you knew you could outpace them.
Richard Davis remembers his grandfather Jack Davis talking about the coming of the crab pots.
My grandfather can remember the first one coming.
I know where the first crab pot come from. You know the Sheringham flowers, don't you? They're in my daughter's just there. Well, that first crab pot was in that shed. And then who brought it? One of the ships, you see, what went out the north for coal. One of ours, you know, the plumper was the other. Then there was the Winter's Hill, another one's the Common. Well, one of them brought a part home.
This recording of Jack Davis was made in 1965. Jack recalled the ships that brought coal from Hartlepool to Cromer when he was a boy.
That Yorkshire for coal. And one of them brought one home, you see. So they got there. You see, where Sanford had his share in the Commerce belonged to Sanford. No. The Commerce belonged to Sanford School, yeah? He got those on a Good Friday. And she brought the pot up. See, there was Austin Blower's captain.
And he said, we tried it, made one or two. And the first people to put them in a long line there, like we put them in, we call shanks, were Runtons. Were the Greens at Runton. They were the first people. They all used to work them as single pots. take them off every day, and or when a part came, they didn't have to take it every day. And he can remember them. And as I say, the greens at East Runton were the first to put them in a line, to haul them quicker, to get back to do the deck chairs. That's right. So they thought, that's a good idea, we'll all do it. They were made from, like, well, if you go north now, they're any piece of wood in the bottom. But as we done them here, I suppose they changed. I think the first ones, what came, were three-bowed. And then we had a four-bowed one here. Where in my time and my grandfather's time, they used to put a oak bottom. And they had a piece of iron in them. Where up north, they mostly had stones in that end. Bit different ground. And they called them music. So I don't know why the hell they got the name music in the bottom. Or a fiddle. But the only thing I thought music's because they had things like, you know, they looked like a piano. But that I don't know.
When this was recorded, Richard had retired from going to sea and is making pots for his son John.
With them, they used to go out, and myself included, when I was younger, because that's the pots we used. We used to go sticking in the winter time, when the sap had gone down off the sticks. Mostly around here we were nut sticks. If you get away and get an elm somewhere, they was better. And I've seen the Sheringham boys, some of them had, I can't think of the name of the wood now. Larch, was it? Silver larch? Something like that. But they used to use them, and they'd be about that long. One, two, three, four bows. And you'd bend them, put them in, and tie your sticks on. A lot more work than these, because we buy these now, or John does. He buy them, well, they come from the Midland somewhere, and he organise what he want, and then they send a couple of hundred to you, and they're already done. Don't get woodworm.
The construction of the pots has changed over the years. Some today use parlour pots.
I ain't got a whole one here because I've just been putting what I call the parlour in this one. But the difference is these are longer, made from steel, and we used to have the spouts what go in. What we have, they call them a crinny. Any nick and cranny, I suppose, it could have started from, but there's two in here, and the bait is in here. They go in after the bait, and then this is what's called a parlour. When they're wet, they go to get out. Well, they don't think about going back to the middle to get out. He'll go around the outside, and then he'll go in here. And this will be where he'll be standing when we go and haul him. Each place has different entrances now. We always had top entrances here. Always, but now they're using them with these, with an entrance here and an entrance here, all different ways. They still work the same. Still work the same as the old ones, but they hold more.
Another pot, with more of its netting in place, helps with the explanation.
This is near enough finished to catch a crab or a lobster. When I said the entrance, the door, that's at the top, okay? We put the bait in here and the crabs come out here, or lobsters. That's the way it happens here. For instance, say this is a piece of fish. That goes in the bar here. Push that button down, and that's very tight, and you won't pull it out, okay? So that's in the middle of the pot. Thrown on the seabed with another line, and if the crabs come along or lobsters come along and they smell the bait, or if it's a clear day they might see it, they come along and they go up or round the pot, and then they go up this entrance and in, and they're eating the bait. Others come behind them, same with this side, they come in eating the bait when they're full up. Or sometimes I don't think you even get to it, because if there's bigger crabs here, they're going round like hell, if you like. And then they go up here. And this is the parlour end. And that floats. So they're in. And again, they're all going round and round and round. This is the parlour. If, for instance, they get out and they're back in there again, they still got a stupidity go around the outside, so they go back in again. Well, we think. Yeah, we get lobsters in these pots, really, more than the old pots. The old pots, where we got a crinny here, this Chris Crinny, the other one would be here, or if you look in the middle here. And sometimes I think the lobsters used to walk through. But here they can't walk through. And there's more space for them. I think they like space. So John's getting bigger lobsters now than I've ever seen. I never had what you call a big lobster. I was more of a crab man for the shop and that. But John likes lobsters. He went to sea with Lenny West from Sheringham. And he taught John a lot of bad habits, if anyone from Sheringham. Look at me.
Richard recalls the rivalry, the banter on the beach.
My father once said, he said, I had a bloody £7, he said. He said, and the same day Kelly come ashore, he said, his was £7, it only had one leg on it. So a £7 was fairly big. Nine was exceptional, but there was one in the paper the other day somewhere else, £10, that's a good fish. But this isn't the ground, we ain't got the big rocks like they got down Devon or Cornwall to hide these big fish, I don't think. But they're still there.
Anglia Television was at Cromer in 1961. David Leader fished from Cromer through that decade.
Judy and Sir Dick Davis and Stony Bly hauling there. There's the pot then emptied and baited up again. There was 25 pots on a shank. In those days, that would be tarred ropes rather than nylon. And the start of the season, that would tear your hands to pieces until you got used to it. And now shooting the shank away there. That could be dangerous. You had to keep your feet well away from the toes as they were going over. There goes the Dan. This is Dennis Gaff in the William Robert. And I think that's Eddie Marsh there and young Collie Crask. There they are hauling again. This is before the hydraulic haulers came in, which made it a lot easier. And cut down on the number of men you needed. When we were going, some of the boats had 3 men crews, others just the 2, and the ones who were 3 men would work more pots to pay for the extra man. Here's the Lewis James with Tuna Harrison and Yakka Harrison, brothers of Kelly, who I used to go to sea with. The Black Booty coming in. Crawler tractors. Now they're the rubber-tired ones. There's Tuna, and I think that's his crew, Sonny Warner. There's the Carnival Queen in, coming in there. That's Kelly Harrison's boat, the one I went in about 12 or 13 years. He was the oldest of the 3 brothers. Nice guy, never had a crossword in all the time I was going with him. There weren't so many trailers in those days, and you'd get up the beach and have to pull the boat off onto stools that held the boat upright, and then the next morning you'd perhaps skeet them down to the water on wooden metal rollers. It was always harder skeeting them down rather than skeeting them up, because you had to get the skeet under the bow and you had to be quick before the boat dug into the beach. That's Shrimp Davis, probably in the KPNK, his boat.
Well, with the crabbing, that's up at daylight. Finish, get ashore by about 10 or 11, pack the crabs, get them away. Lunch, perhaps have a couple hours in the afternoon to make up for the early morning, and then perhaps start repairing gear or getting new gear ready for the next day's fishing.
Nearly all the fish shops had facilities for cooking and cleaning the crabs in those days. And there's the lobster's been cleaned after being cooked, ready to go on the shop slab. Oh, that was pretty well 95% crab to 5% lobster catch. There was always a big demand for lobsters. You could never catch enough. I know this is Charlie Cox, who had the shop in New Street, which is still going under the name of Jonas now. This one is Bob Davis's at the top of the gangway, now run by his son, Billy.
There are many more aspects to the fisherman's life to what we can show here. Nicknames and superstitions, step dancing and deck chairs, tripping, beach huts and recipes are amongst those things we cannot cover. The role of the fisherman's wife at the heart of the family is a story in itself. And because we've seen much of one of their roles, the traditional knitted gansey, we'll include it here. Brenda Stibbons has knitted and studied ganseys. Her grandmother was one of the large Harrison fishing family. She knitted a gansey for Richard Davis, which is now on Henry Blogg's mannequin at the Lifeboat Museum.
The guernsey is the traditional garment worn by fishermen in all parts of the UK. Today I'm knitting on a circular needle, which is a lot easier because the stitches don't fall off the end of the needles. But originally they would have used 5 double-pointed needles and would have used a sheath which was fitted at the waist. They were knitted in the round, which means having cast on the stitches, you just knit round and round until you come up to shape for the armholes when they're divided. Once the body has been knitted, the sleeves are knitted downwards, finishing at the cuffs. This means that if the elbows or the cuffs become worn, as in this case, they can be unpicked and just the bottom of the sleeves re-knitted, which makes the guernsey last a lot longer. The wool knitted would be a very strong 5-ply worsted weave yarn, which is very hard wearing, and the needles would be very fine. Often guernseys were knitted on something like a size 17 needle. The use of different patterns from different villages is traditionally believed to have been so that if the body of a fisherman was washed up on the beach, whoever found him could find out where he came from by the pattern of the guernsey he was wearing. Whether this is true or not, I'm not sure, but there are very many different patterns which are often linked with different areas. When knitting the guernseys, the initials of the owner were often incorporated into the patterns. The makeup of the patterns is often based on traditional seafaring patterns. There's a diamond shape, which is the net mesh. There's a ladder pattern. Cable patterns, as in this one, represent ropes, and this one has a flag. Anchors were often used as well, and there's another pattern called marriage lines, which is a zigzag pattern, which is supposed to represent the ups and downs of married life. On this guernsey here, the pattern is mainly cables, with a central panel of anchors, and at the top of the sleeves, there's a rib pattern which gives the impression of a ladder. This guernsey was knitted for Richard Davis, who specifically asked to have shorter sleeves because then he didn't have to push them up which was what he usually did to avoid getting them tangled. Although the pattern of a Guernsey looks complicated, it is very easy to knit. One of the best books that I found on the tradition of knitting Guernseys and fishermen's sweaters was by Gladys Thompson, called Patterns for Guernseys, Jerseys and Arans. She collected more than one pattern from Sheringham, so it's possible that these were knitted by different families. Some fishermen would buy their Guernseys once machine knitting came into being, and these tended to have a lot plainer patterns with the body in a stocking stitch and a fairly simple yoke.
In the present decade, a crab and lobster weekend in the third week of May has become a very popular event. Linked with the weekend, there have been decorated crustacea, deck chairs and windbreaks. Businesses in the towns may have nothing direct to do with the fishing, but know that a thoroughly enjoyable weekend will bring in custom. A joint initiative between the two town mayors in 2010, there's a combined concert on the Friday evening at Cromer Pier Pavilion, followed by 2 days of various events for the Saturday and Sunday. Lots of local societies join in, and the town museums are a hive of activity. A large crab from Delia Smith proved very popular, and music and a range of arts are all part of the fun. In Sheringham, the seafront car park and the nooks and crannies of the streets behind are filled with stalls. In Cromer, the promenade and pier are the normal venue. Some of the traditional crafts we featured in this documentary are on display. And there's plenty of advice on the cooking of both crabs and lobsters from local celebrity chefs. The catching of crabs is always a favourite on Cromer Pier. The festival has included the world's pier crab catching contest. Though the shore crabs caught there might be a bit fed up with being caught and then consigned back to the water again and again. There are plenty of activities for children, and the outdoor entertainments usually manage to bridge the age gap with a mixture of spoken and slapstick fun. Whether it's the gastronomic enjoyment of fresh crab and lobster or cuddly replicas, it's a weekend for all to enjoy. With the challenge of meeting the needs of the market and of simply making a living on an exposed northern coast, the boats prepare to set out for a new season. The slopes of Sheringham are today less busy, but the skiffs of the part-timers enable them to make the most of their opportunities. Most of the activity has moved to Cromer's East Beach, where a new generation of fishermen continues to seek to harvest the seas. Before first light, the activity begins. Tractor engines cough into life, and the tractor driver moves between different boats, pushing each one in turn down to the water's edge and into the surf. Onto the water, and each boat is in its proper element. Powerful outboard motors drive through the water. A quick rinse of the kit, and the pot hauler is soon at work, bringing the first shank up from the seabed. Quick hands clear the pot of starfish, old bait and undersized crabs. Fresh bait is put in place. If you're quick, you may have the job done before the next pot reaches the surface, but more than likely you have to knock the hauler out of gear for a few moments while you finish the job. The whole shank of pots is stacked in the boat until every pot has been refreshed. At the next sight, you spot your marker flag and then begin hauling again. As each pot comes over the side, you hope for the sight of a shell or two that will tell you all your effort is worthwhile. And then it's clear the pot and refresh the bait all over again. Beckhithe Hole, the ground off Overstrand and Sidestrand, is favoured in the early season, but the pots will gradually be moved out over the following weeks. The stern of the boat fills with a pile of pots and you head off to where you think you'll give it another try. Over the side with the first of the pots and a very gentle speed on the boat as you lay out the line. After the last crab pot, over goes the anchor, and then you'll mark a buoy. You'll be needing to find that again tomorrow. As you work, others around you are going through much the same process. On the journey home, there may be a few words to exchange, perhaps of mutual commiseration or of encouragement on a good day. Then it's full power on the engines and back to the beach. The boat is left in the shallows as you trudge up to collect your tractor and haul your vessel onto its trailer. In the current age, questions arise from some concern for the chalk reef, which is the home of the crabs and lobsters. But 1,000 years of a traditional style of fishing has played its part in maintaining a balance and has conserved the grounds. The two museums in Cromer and the Mo Museum in Sheringham all care for the heritage and tradition of the towns and villages. But the business of hunting for crabs and lobsters is not memories, it's a daily and ongoing challenge for those who are at their work long before most of us